Philippine shares continued to outperform regional peers, jumping 75 points on Monday to close at 66.81. For more on the market action, Jonas Reveles of E-Management for Business and Marketing Services joins us live. Hi, Jonas. Good to see you.
Hi. Good morning, Mimi.
Good morning. So, Jonas, the local market is in a five-day winning streak, now at a resistance 6,600, and value picked up to over 8 billion on Monday. Does it look like investors are starting to come back to the market meaningfully, or should we be cautious at this point?
Well, I think given the third quarter numbers, market wasn't really expecting a good third quarter GDP. Most of the forecasts were below 7%. I guess this eventually just highlights the investors are, you know, quite surprised how resilient consumption is in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. So this is, I think, it's slightly perking up the market. I think the key resistance we're all watching is around 6,800. Mm-hmm. So this is something that I'm currently watching, whether that level could be broken, as that could actually be a major sign that we probably bottomed out. That's based on the charts, of course. But if we look at the fundamentals today, inflation and interest rates have yet to peak. So this is something that could actually put a cap at 6,800.
All right. You know, Jonas, two things that many are watching out for today would be window dressing, because it's end of the month and tomorrow's a holiday, and the MSCI rebalancing. How do you see the needle moving short term? I mean, some are warning we are already nearing overbought levels already.
Oh, well, I think we've passed the 6,500. It was a key resistance. 6.8 is a number that I think could be a ceiling that the market. Sad to say that my year-end number is still closer to 6,000 as a year-end number. As you know, market realize inflation is still here. And the concerns over high interest rates. Last night, the Fed highlighted that they will continue to raise interest rates. So it's just a question whether they'll start slowing down in their December meet or probably next year. Mm-hmm. And my perspective is that they're not yet finished with the slightly higher rates.
Huh. You know, there seems to be a consensus that the markets are now downgrading their expectations. You know, they're going to be happy. Markets are already happy with just a slowdown, not exactly a pivot. Jonas, I'm very curious, when you talk to CEOs and when you talk to investors, two sides of the group there, do you think there's a mismatch about expectations, whether, you know, where earnings are headed, with the cost of financing still going up, or whether earnings revisions might go down further than either of them see, considering where value is at this point?
Okay, that's a very good question. And I guess looking at the earnings forecast in start of the year, these were practically flat, which could be reflective of the higher cost of doing business. However, the fact is, sooner or later, one has to give. If inflation doesn't peak in the Philippines, which could probably peak in the first quarter of 2023, then there could be some earnings adjustments to be made for 2023. Mm-hmm. So that, I think, at this point in time, it's nice for budgets of companies to actually accept a much higher inflation and higher cost of doing business in 2023, so that actually potential earnings could actually be trimmed.
Mm-hmm. You know, for the past 5 days, Jonas, the Philippines managed to go up, defying, you know, regional slump on a day-to-day basis. But today, the market appears to have succumbed to pressure from the neighborhood with what's happening in China. You know, lots of residents there growing very impatient with the government's zero COVID policy. The index today finally succumbing to selling pressure, down by about 0.75%, 45 points. We're at 66.36. If I were to ask you, Jonas, what do you think is going to move the needle more? The local side of things, the local optimism, or the global regional pressures we're seeing from our neighbors?
Well, I think one of the things that will be, that could actually put a cap on the market, is the next print of inflation, which is most likely higher than 7.7, most likely closer to 8.4%.
Huh. All right, all right. Jonas, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. Globe Telecom saying that their January to September CapEx spend is already up 14% to 74.7. Their full year CapEx is at 89. They're saying that they're, you know, pulling out all the stops to make sure that the network rollout is on track. Just a few days ago, PLDT said the same thing, that CapEx spend was up. They're very bullish on spending for the future. These are good indicators, right?
Yes, because one is that I think that one of the headlines the past few days was the government is planning to extend the work from home as part of BESA strategy. So again, this is something that we are all benefiting from the slightly weaker peso, and we've seen the resilience of the BPO sector. Probably in a year or two, you know, this is something very significant that BPO revenue can probably overtake OFW remittances.
All right. Another interesting story, DMCI. Sid Consun, he's saying they're going to venture into agri, specifically in palm oil. They're also looking at management of agri lands in southern Visayas and Mindanao. What does this do to the DMCI brand? I mean, we know that DMCI is a dividend play. Does this make it even more attractive?
Well, it highlights diversification, but you know, they also have the Sanji mangoes. So they've actually been in agri for a while. It's just that I guess this one is something more because we're seeing a lot of need for the Philippines. You know, a lot of people, and we've hear a lot of, you know, people talk about ESG. It's time to actually add another letter to ESG. It's the letter R, not for Ravelas, but for resiliency. So right. For a country like Philippines, we really need to become self-sufficient. And probably palm oil is another alternative to oil.
Jonas, I'm curious, when you look 5-10 years down the road, do you see agri becoming a big player? Because right now, if you look at the big players here, it's retail, it's banking, it's property. And the agri, you know, listed companies in agri, just a few and far between. But now that you've got DMCI getting into agriculture, Manny Pangilinan himself is getting into it with a purchase of Carmen's Best. That's their foray, that's their initial entry into it. Do you think agri will become a big contender in the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, come to think of it, yes, mainly because one, we're at a period where, you know, inflation, what we saw in the last 2.5 years, supply chain disruptions, it's nice to have food security into our situation. We've seen this administration really focus on the agriculture. They've highlighted, the president highlighted this in his State of the Nation address. One of the things that we've seen with PLDT and Globe, strengthening the digitalization could actually empower the agricultural sector, no? And use the digitalization like Grab to be able to deliver produce from farm to consumers faster.
All right. It's
so like this is that is, you know, this is something that is a part of the changing landscape.
All right. It's a domino effect, really. Connected. Everyone's connected. This one, good news from the ERC. The ERC is suspending the collection of feed-in tariff allowance from December this year to February next year to help ease inflation burden on consumers. Also this one, Dennis Ois Phoenix Petroleum and Lushatan's Absolute Distillers have reached an agreed and reasonable payment plan for the 157 million peso bill. Dennis Ois Empire, what's happening there? How are investors taking the news cycle on a Davao-based businessman, Dennis Ois?
I think one of the things that highlighted is the weaker currency. So once we get things settled in an economy that right now we're starting to see the peso stabilize, although there are still risks, once the engines of business, and we've seen the resiliency in the third quarter, sooner or later, their businesses will normalize as the economy eventually punches into a higher speed. I guess the only thing that we need to hurdle is the higher inflation.
All right. And banking now. Security Bank has partnered with Malaysia's Consulsys to improve branches. So it's better banking, they're saying, with a digital state-of-the-art technology. Also this one, mining boss Alfredo Ramos of Atlas Consolidated has passed away. So ANC sends its condolences to the family. Of course, the Ramos family also owns National Bookstore. And we have this just in. House of Investments is going to co-invest in RCBC Trust. RCBC had said that they're going to spin off the trust into its standalone trust corporation. Jonas, how should investors take this kind of news?
Oh, well, basically, I guess, given the situation, there are a lot of things to be done in the Philippine economy. You know, in the last few years, prior to the pandemic, remember, we broke the 3,000 per capita GDP. And typically, World Bank and most of the studies will tell you that we could see the potential J-curve rise. Probably, people are not really looking at the impact, but if you look at the GDP numbers that we had since the pandemic, we've been constantly been running our household spending closer to around 7 to 8%. And this has been a solid number. If you compare that to the previous years, this is actually something that appears to be more sustainable.
Okay.
And you know, one thing is that there are a lot of things to be people to look at in investing. And we know that 5-10 years down the road, food, retail, construction, and real estate are still the sectors that will lead the Philippine economy. And people are looking at these opportunities to, you know, take the present crisis and as an opportunity to, you know, invest in.
All right.
Attract a lot of people.
All right. That sounds like a good forecast there. Jonas, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I think you like the stock. Don't tell us. Describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us?
Okay. Well, basically, this stock eventually highlighted a major bottom. It staged a rally. Similarly to the market, it seems that it's moving into a little bit of correction, maybe 1-2% correction. And most likely it will reattempt the recent highs of the year as the next move. So I think this is more of a technical play, but this could be a signal that you know, this stock might have already turned a corner.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Jonas, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
All right.
And have a good day.
Have a good day.